Well, hello everyone. My name is Professor Mark Lundstrom. I'll be teaching this course. And before we dive in, I'd just like to say a few words about the course and give you a few tips for how you can be successful in this course. So it's a course about transistors, one particular kind of transistor. This is a photo of the very first transistor invented at Bell Labs in 1948. Nobody really knew what a big deal it was at that time. It was announced in the New York Times. It was buried somewhere inside the New York Times, but it sure has become a big deal. In fact, some will argue that the transistor was the most important invention of the 20th century. It has a really interesting history. A lot of really interesting people were involved in this. There's a pointer here where you can go and learn more about that. It's a fascinating story. I encourage you to do that. So the continued evolution and enhancement of transistors and their and the use of them in integrated circuits really drove the development of electronics and has produced what we take for granted today, all of the electronics that have shaped the modern world. Probably the most notable example are these smartphones that we all carry around. There are billions and billions of these transistors inside our smartphones. But this is a course about transistors. How does each one of those billions of transistors operate? This is a cross-section of a silicon MOSFET, one that's a few years old now, but the principles are still the same. There's a terminal over here we labeled a source. That's a source of electrons. There's a terminal we labeled the gate. If we apply the correct voltage to the gate terminal, it allows electrons to flow out of the source, across the channel, and into this third region that we labeled the drain. And that's how the MOSFET works. We control the flow of electrons from one terminal to the other with a third terminal that is in the middle. So the first objective of this course is to develop a very solid, simple physical understanding of how this device operates. We're especially interested in how the device operates when it becomes very, very small. Recently, in the past decade or so, transistor dimensions have been pushed down to incredibly small dimensions, nanoscale dimensions. So we want to develop a physical understanding of how electrons and holes flow in these very small devices. And then we want to relate that understanding to the currents that we measure when we apply voltages to the terminals. We want to relate that physics to the current voltage characteristics of the transistor and understand what types of characteristics make transistors good in certain types of applications, digital electronics, analog electronics primarily. So those are our objectives. A lot of this course will consist of topics that have been important for transistors for many, many years, but there will be a couple of aspects of the course that are different and which you won't find in any textbook. One is to try to bring in the understanding that has developed over the past 30 years about how electrons flow at the nanoscale, at very small dimensions, and bring that understanding, that scientific understanding that was developed over the past few decades to the understanding of present-day MOSFET technology, because the critical dimensions, the channel lengths of these transistors has shrunk to the kinds of incredibly small length scales where all of our traditional theories about electron transport break down. But we now know, we now have developed new ways to understand and model and simulate these devices. And we want to bring that understanding to bear on these very small transistors with channel lengths of 20 nanometers or even 10 nanometers or less. Okay, so the course consists of 5 units. And the first unit will be a little bit about transistors as a black box, what happens when we apply voltages, what current flows, just to get familiar with them, and the kinds of circuits that they're used in, and some metrics that will allow us to tell a good transistor for a particular type of application. Unit 2 is probably the most important unit. If you take nothing out of the course, you really want to understand Unit 2. Unit 2 is about a simple physical way to understand the operations of both long channel transistors and short channel transistors. Very little mathematics, but a simple physical arguments that will give us good understanding of how these devices work. Unit 3 is a traditional topic, MOS electrostatics, about how the voltages we apply to the terminals affect the electric fields inside the device and how those affect the performance of the device. And then Unit 4 will bring this new understanding of current flow at the nanoscale to the MOSFET and will develop a very physically sound but very simple understanding of very small devices that can also be applied to the more traditional long channel devices as well. And then there are a few additional topics that we will wrap the course up with, and we'll even talk about some other kinds of transistors. So this course is not completely about MOSFETs, even though we'll mostly be talking about MOSFETs. Now, what I'd just like to tell you now is about how the course will work. There are five units I mentioned. Each unit consists of a number of lectures, about 20 minutes long or so, a set of homework problems and some solutions, and an exam for each of the five units. So if you go to a particular lecture, you'll see that associated with each particular video lecture that you'll be watching is a quiz, a very short quiz of five questions so that you can make sure that you got the main points from that lecture. If you didn't, you can go back and quickly review. There is a short problem. That short problem is something that in most cases you should be able to do fairly quickly if you've followed the main points of that lecture. I don't aim to post solutions to those problems. What I'd encourage you to do is to get on the discussion forum, discuss your answers, talk back and forth. If we see the discussion going in the wrong direction or if people are having trouble getting to where we'd like you to be, we'll jump in and help guide the discussion. Now, each of the units also has a set of homework problems and solutions and an online test. The homework is assigned, but it's not graded. You should spend some time understanding the problems, try to work them before you see the solutions and understand the solutions. There is a test. It is a short test, and it's based on the homework. So if you understand the homework problems, you'll be well prepared for the test. There'll be numerical answers required, so you should be sure to bring a calculator. It's closed book. I'll provide a formula sheet that has more than enough formulas, so you won't need to memorize long, complicated formulas. Now, there'll be five of those, and if you're working for a certificate or a grade as a Purdue student, you'll need to take all five of those courses. Now, if you're an online student pursuing a certificate, this is the way the grading will work. These short lecture quizzes will follow each lecture. They're timed. It should take you probably no more than 10 minutes, but because of the limitations of the platform, you'll have 30 minutes. So more than enough time to answer those five questions, multiple choice questions. There'll be 32 lectures, so there are 32 of those lecture quizzes. Your lowest six will be dropped when we compute your score. That means there are 130 points possible from those quizzes. Each unit is followed by a unit exam that is based on the homework problems. Those exams are short. They're only two problems. They're timed. They should take you, I think, 20 minutes or so. Because of the limitations on the platform, I'm not able to give you 20 minutes, so you'll have 60 minutes. That should be more than enough time to take each of these short unit exams. There'll be five of those. Your lowest score in the first four will be dropped when we compute your total score, and you must take the last one to complete the course, and that one will be counted. So there are a maximum of 160 points available, 40 points for each of the five problems, each of the five unit exams, and your lowest one is dropped. So if you're working towards a certificate, there'll be a maximum of 290 points from the quizzes and the unit exams. And if you achieve 70% of those or more, you'll have earned a certificate. Now, if you're a Purdue student, and we have both online students and we have Purdue students who are taking the online course and are here on campus or in the Purdue online system as well, you will take those quizzes and those online unit exams also, but in addition, you'll take a proctored exam on campus. And that proctored exam will be very similar to the unit exams. So the unit exam is a good way to prepare for it. And the same rules will apply. The lowest, you'll need to take all of them. The lowest one of the first four will be dropped in computing your score. So that adds another 160 points to the Purdue students. So you'll have a total of 450 points possible. Okay. So all the same policies apply for the, you'll be taking the same quizzes and the same online unit exams, and the proctored exams will operate in the same way that the unit exams did. Okay, so here are the dates. I'll be administering these proctored exams on campus. You'll need a calculator to produce numerical answers. Purdue has an official calculator that is allowed for exams, so be sure that you get one of these TI scientific calculators. Now, the online forum, I hope you all will make use of the online forum, discuss the short problems and any other questions that you have about the material. I encourage the Purdue students to use the online forum as well, and we'll have a much richer and more extensive discussion. And in addition, Purdue students are encouraged to contact me during my office hours. Now, you won't need a textbook for this course. There is a reference. The reference is this set of lecture notes, Fundamentals of Nanotransistors, that I wrote. These set of lecture notes go into more detail about the topics that we'll be discussing. I will provide a list of reading suggestions for each of the lectures, so you'll know where you need to go if you'd like to dive deeper and get more information. The book is a supplement. It's not required. You can do just fine in this course without the book, but the book is there for those who want to go deeper. And I will be providing a draft copy of this textbook to any student who is registered in this course. So the approach we'll be taking is we'll be emphasizing sound, physical, simple, intuitive understanding of how transistors operate. If you're a transistor developer, or if you're going to be doing that in your career, this will be a good place for you to get started, but you will have to dive deeper into the various aspects that we discuss. But I hope that it will provide you a good starting point. If you're a transistor user, my goal is to prepare you to be a knowledgeable user of these devices in circuits and other applications. So just to summarize, this course is all about gaining a clear physical understanding of this important device, all the way from the long channel devices that were first developed and still used from time to time, to the very short channel transistors that power the modern electronics today. To take this course, you need a basic understanding of semiconductor physics. You may have gotten that in a previous edX course or in another semiconductor course, but if you understand semiconductor fundamentals, band structures, doping, effective masses, things like that, you'll be ready to dive into this course. I'd also like to mention that this is part of a new initiative here at Purdue to produce a suite of one-credit courses on a wide variety of topics to allow people to get much more breadth than they could normally get in traditional three-credit courses. So this is one of those courses in that new initiative. So I'm looking forward to teaching the course. I'm looking forward to having you in the course. Good luck in the course, and I'll see you in Unit 1.